Hey guys, we're back here at Cyril Stokes. There was just so much to see that we had to come back.
There certainly was, Claire, and I would love to ask Cyril about a few particular items of his collection because I need to get a few details about them.
Well, let's go and do it. Now, Cyril, we've spent quite a lot of time in your house and looked at a lot of things, and I thought it's about time we found out a little bit more about you. So the first thing I want to know is, what was the first object you ever purchased?
The first thing was a piece of porcelain, Chelsea, 1750s, one of the Four Seasons, and I bought it off an antique dealer who I knew, been to his home, Bob Brand. It was at the top of Burke Street, near Parliament House. And I should have bought every piece he had in the shop, but I didn't have the money.
When was that?
Well, it was about 60 years ago.
That's quite a while. Early 50s, absolutely.
Ah, it's the Huntsman. So I've heard you got a little bit of a story about this one, Cyril.
Well, the story is that the dogs came from the exhibition buildings in Melbourne, the famous building, which on one side had a fire many years ago, and this was damaged in the fire. Somehow it finished up in the back part of a nursery, badly damaged. And from there it went to as I understand it, Ron McCann's auction room, and we purchased it there, had it restored, and brought it up here. Of course, we had to have cranes because of the big blue stone on the bottom. And the interesting thing is, when the exhibition buildings had their centenary, they wanted to buy it back, but it was a main feature of Forest Glade, and we weren't prepared to sell it.
Can you tell me a bit about how you restored the statue?
I wasn't there to watch it, but like the arm, for instance, quite a bit was missing.
Okay.
And some of the dogs, so the bronze had to be put back on again. They did a very good job. There's a copy of it in Beverly Hills. I think there's one in Sydney as well. It's a French bronze. That's the first major statue in the garden after the 83 fires.
So Cyril, you bought your first piece. I think it was the one with little cherubs and things on. And how did it build from there? What really got you into this, what is now an absolutely fantastic collection?
Well, at one stage, I worked for a Godfrey Hayes, who was an antique dealer in Richmond and a valuer for the Customs Department.
Mm-hmm.
And he taught me a lot about antiques and I've been collecting them all my life.
So when did you purchase this property?
About 50 years ago.
50 years ago, okay. And what was here then?
It was a holiday centre for the Newton family.
Really?
Weekend place.
Okay, and can you tell us what happened in 1983?
1983, unfortunately, the Ash Wednesday fires came. And the house and more than half of the gardens were totally destroyed.
So everything we see now has basically been, the house has been rebuilt,
yes,
etc. So at that stage you didn't have your collection here then, did you, in 83?
We had some nice things,
mm-hmm,
but we didn't have any warning.
Right.
So five people were burnt to death on the road, so we were, counted ourselves very lucky we were able to escape.
Cyril, how on earth did you get a statue that size in your garden?
Well, of course, it came in many pieces. It weighed so many tonnes that had to be cut up and boxed separately, even for a crane to lift. But we expect to have it finished in another fortnight.
So with the crane, how many men did it take to get it there?
Three.
Three men, gosh. And if you were to cut up a statue, does that decrease the value of it in any way? Or is there a way of getting it back together?
No, when it's finished, you won't be able to tell it's been cut up.
And what can you tell me about it? What's so special about it to you?
Well, there's nothing else like it in Australia, I'm sure. Randolph Hearst had enough money to be able to buy the best things around the world. And when it's finished and you see it, it really is a magnificent thing.
I certainly believe it'll be a real eye-catcher. And is there anything else from that particular collection that you have your eye on?
We have purchased several stained glass windows from his collection.
And the detail in the statue itself, is there any bits of details that you like in particular?
I like the angels on the sides. And in the middle, it goes two more cupids higher up, and a peculiar face of a laughing guy in the middle. I'm not sure what it's supposed to represent, but it will look magnificent when it's all up.
And just looking at it, Cyril, you see just the fine bits of work that's gone into it. It would have just taken years to get something like that completed, so I certainly appreciate it. So this week, Claire and I have booted Jeff out of Nostalgia Corner because we decided some of us were born in the 90s and we would like to reflect on that this week. So Claire, what can you remember about our childhoods?
Well, I remember being obsessed with Pokemon. Pokemon cards, Pokemon everything. I had a Pokemon birthday cake when I was about 7 or so.
Oh, so you're a diehard fan of Pokemon.
I was a diehard fan.
Who was your favourite character?
Pikachu.
Pikachu.
I did remember all the names of the 150 Pokemon that was around, and now it's increased somehow.
Well, I actually watched Dragon Ball Z because I was a bit more of a blokey girl growing up, but I watched Dragon Ball Z and then I realised that they showed the picture for too long and I just got over it. But I grew up out of that. What else do you remember, Claire?
I remember Barbies, Bratz dolls. What else?
So I did not ever get into Bratz and Barbies and stuff like that again. I was too busy running around in mud. But my sister loved Baby Borns. And she would always walk around the house with her Baby Born. And I was like,
I was
wish I was cool enough to do that.
Never got one.
And I remember Tamagotchis, Claire.
Oh, Tamagotchis. They were the best.
Yeah, but I never, again, just didn't like them. I just didn't get into them. Tell me about your Tamagotchi.
Well, everyone used to have one in primary school. We used to keep it around our necks and and you'd have to feed them and clean them and
to
and
feed them.
Make them, yeah, to feed
with
them.
Virtual food.
The virtual
right.
food.
Yeah.
You had to play with them and they would cry and pretty much the teachers would all be angry because we'd all be looking at our Tamagotchis all the time.
And you couldn't put them on silent?
No.
That wasn't how they worked. What else did we have, Claire? Like, I remember the tape players. We used to always record the radio to make sure I had my Shania Twain on set. But I remember when the Discmans came out, I could then listen to Shania Twain on a Discman on the car trips and things like that, which reminds me again, I used to always get a TV hits from the supermarket. Every car trip I went on, my dad would be like, you can all choose a magazine, and that was it. And my little brother got Total Girl, so we teased him. We're like, you're a fan of Delta Goodrum, sucked in. But, you know, I did. I love TV hits because I collected all the posters and had them all over my bedroom wall. So I thought I was pretty cool back then. What magazines did you collect?
Well, I liked a bit of, Total Girl, definitely. A bit of K-Zone. And then I moved on into Dolly and girlfriend.
Okay. Yeah. Again, we're very different, Claire. We were very different. But my brother's got K-Zone as well.
Yeah, definitely.
Because they needed to catch up on their Dragon Ball Z.
It was very big back then.
Obviously, I was raised with brothers. Were you a fan of Shakira?
I was Shakira more into back Britney Spears
Britney
and
Spears.
Spice Girls and definitely Backstreet Boys.
Backstreet Boys, okay.
I was obsessed.
Yeah. I think I was just a Shakira and Shania Twain kind of person back then.
I did love Shania Twain though.
You did? Yes. What's your favourite song?
Man, I Feel Like a Woman.
Right, everyone's favourite song is Man, I Feel Like a Woman. Girl power! All right, well, I think that's enough for the nostalgia corner, but there you have a bit of insight on the 90s as a kid.
So Cyril, after the 83 fires, this house was completely rebuilt and most of the gardens were redone, is that right?
That's correct. We actually needed a house in a hurry, so we bought a Glenville house.
Oh, really?
But we made a mistake. They found it difficult to get tradespeople up here and it took about 2 years to build. So we were living in the cottage at that time. And of course, we were restoring the gardens.
Yes, okay, good. And I guess the really burning question for me is you've been collecting for, 60 odd years, maybe a bit more. Is it still a burning passion for you? Do you still get great joy out of finding that wonderful object?
Yes. Just today, while you've been viewing in other rooms, I've been on the computer trying to find out where our goods from Los Angeles are, $250,000. And where another assignment from Edinburgh, Scotland is. Mm-hmm. The passion is greater now than it's ever been.
Cyril, I absolutely love this marble top cabinet. Can you tell me about it?
Well, it's an interesting story. Bonhams brought it down to Como to show dealers and important buyers. And talking to James Handy, I expressed my interest in buying it. The estimate was $15,000. We didn't exactly have anywhere to put it at the moment. We didn't imagine that we could put furniture in the gallery, but it fits in quite well. So I was bidding on the kitchen phone, which was in that corner, and the back door is here. And I stopped bidding at $21,000 because there's 25% commission and the quote to bring it down to Melbourne was $2,000. And my partner Trevor came in the back door here and said, what's it up to? And I said, $31,000. And the girl on the phone said, congratulations, Mr. Stokes, he's just knocked it down to you. I thought we were going to have a divorce. But actually, it's by one of the most important cabinet makers in France in the 18th century, and he did me a great favour that day, or I would have missed it.
Fantastic story. So you paid $10,000 too much, but you love it so much, you're glad you did.
Yes, it's worth every penny.
Oh, thanks for coming back again. Hey, have a look at this lovely picture. Reminds me a little of me mum and dad. Wish I had a photograph of them. Did I tell you about me family last week? What a rum lot we was. Oh, and me father, George Eddowes, married me mum, Catherine Evans, in 1832. They were 21 and she was 16. The first of 12 children came soon after. Crikey, he must have liked me mum. Well, Dad used to call me Chick, on account of me being small. This is what he did me, Dad. He used to make things out of tin. Well, some calls it hollowware or tinware. They were real good at this. Sometimes he'd bring things home to work on. I remember on cold nights lying in bed, oh, with him tap, tap, tapping away. Ooh. And he used to make magic tricks and he'd sell them all round the markets. Watch the milk disappear. See? Magic. But I'm not telling you how though. Dad always said, don't tell the monks. Oh, bleeding late, always bleeding late. Got to run. But I'll see you next time. If I'm lucky, I'll have some coins to show you.
G'day everyone. Behind me today is probably one of my favourite advertising pieces that's in my collection. It's the Palais de Danse advertising poster that would have sat out the front of the St Kilda Palais in probably early 1920s, straight after the First World War. Advertising a dancing competition. How times have changed. Now this poster was acquired by me just recently actually from the late Bill Howard's collection. It wasn't cheap, it cost me nearly $8,000, and it's canvas on a type of cardboard backing. But to me, it was worth every cent. It's one of the pieces that I do truly love.
Cyril, do you take time out sometimes to actually walk outside and enjoy your collection, walk around and look at the things, perhaps take a tinny of beer with you?
Normally if I'm walking around, it's to see where we can improve the situation, where by moving things it can look better. We're making a new section of garden now. And we are recognised as one of Australia's greatest private gardens. We're just trying to improve it all the time, the same as we're trying to improve the collection all the time. And at the moment, we're waiting for a 150-year-old ivory cabinet that was made in Italy. It won the gold medal at the Sorrento exhibition 150 years ago. We bought it in the United States. Bonham's auction rooms believe it's the greatest ivory cabinet they've ever seen, but we have to get the American government's permission for it to come here and the Australian government's permission to have it. We believe we'll get that because this is open to the public to come on tours and it will never be sold.
Cyril, can you tell me about those plates? They look really interesting.
Yes, well, one of the advantages of travelling overseas, you find a variety of things. In the United States, the Sèvres Company, which is the number one French porcelain, made the greatest production, a dinner service for 800 people for Catherine the Great of Russia. And we were fortunate enough in the United States to find a dozen of these plates.
Okay, what I've seen these plates, Cyril, is a royal crown, a royal crest.
Yes.
And then around the outside, there's some little, I would describe them as cartouches, I guess, some little vignettes of people's heads. Presumably they're part of the Russian royal family, I'm guessing. And we've got some laurel leaves in there and just some very, very, very interesting gold outlay and some nice little pink flowers right round the edge. So very, very ornate.
Well, you can imagine they would need something like that in the Great Palace.
I'm just trying to think, you know, 800 people, How long's the table?
I don't know, but think of the poor people washing up all the dishes by hand.
The washer-upper is, yeah, and you wouldn't want to chip any. You'd be in great trouble, wouldn't you? Just notice that wedged in between these Catherine the Great plates, there's this little collection of cups and saucers by Meissen. What can you tell me about those?
Yes, very important set. We have a lot of Meissen, but this is probably the most important.
Mm-hmm.
And it's from the 1700s and by an artist by the name of Regina. And very, extremely rare. Very lucky to find another set anywhere else in the world. You'll notice that each plate and each cup is painted differently. And I particularly like the one with the leopards on. But they're exceptional, quite exceptional.
So it's the one at the back, isn't it? The one with the leopards? I can see that. Why are the cups so small?
Well, they're so small because tea was so expensive. It was a luxury in those days. And I assume, it's my own idea, that they had to get tea to travel in sailing ships a long way.
Mm-hmm.
But all of the cups that we've got from that period are very small.
Very small. They look almost like a modern demi-tasse type coffee cup or something. But I'm glad we stumbled over those. They are really, really interesting. Now, Jan, you've got a great mystery object for me, and some of our viewers had a bit of trouble with this last week getting it right, but we did have a winner. So can you tell us exactly what this beautiful, ornate ceramic object is?
Yes, it's a piece of Minton. It's 19th century. It looks a little bit like a wheelbarrow that's full of flowers, quite ornate.
And?
And there is a little bit of a mystery to it. There's a little lid here on the top.
Right.
Which, as you can see,
reveals an inkwell.
Reveals an inkwell.
So, if you contacted me last week and said it's an inkwell, you could well be the winner. So, well done.
Jeff, this season we have an awesome prize package for the mystery object winner each week. We're offering a subscription to Antiques and Collectibles for Pleasure and for Profit, as well as a subscription to The Collecting Bug Online, which is worth over $300.
Wow. And we've also got a $100 gift voucher to the Amazing Mill Markets, a double pass to the Stokes Collection, and a double pass to Ballarat Exhibition Centre, Old Trades Fair, that's coming up later on this year.
So altogether, it's worth over $550. So get your entries in. It's very well worth it.
Okay, we've been strolling through the Cyril Stokes Gardens today up here in Mount Macedon, and I was really, really happy to find this picture sculpture. That's sitting next to me. It's a sculpture of a number of Aboriginal gentlemen's faces. It's an interesting sculpture, and it's by a sculptor that a lot of you should know. So today's mystery object question is, who was the sculptor? So write in with your answers, awa@academics.com.au, and may the best person win.
Well, it looks like we finally found the Japanese garden. However, it's a shame because we are at the end of a very special two episodes of Antiques with Attitude. A big thank you to Cyril Stokes for allowing us into his home and seeing his fabulous collection.
And the gardens are beautiful, truly remarkable.
I think we've absolutely been privileged today to come and look at these, the gardens and the collection. And to end up here in the Japanese garden is a wonderful, wonderful spot. So, viewers, if you wish to talk to us about what you've seen over the past 2 weeks or have any other comments or queries to make, awa@academics.com.au.
We'll see you next week.